Hello there.
Welcome to the Nerd Party.
Hi, this is Nick Anastasiou, story editor on Star Wars The Clone Wars and Star Wars Bad Batch. And you are listening to Aggressive Negotiations.
I'd like to talk to you about aggressive negotiations. Sorry for the inside joke there, but if you follow Matt and myself around, you just got it. And that little joke is for all of us. I am Jedi Master John Mills, and I am here on Aggressive Negotiations, joined with my esteemed Jedi Master friend, Matthew Rushing, who is very busy right now peering into the future, trying to see what the magic eight ball of destiny tells him about the future of the Star Wars movies. How's that going for you, Matt?
It's going well. I'm shaking it up, and it says, it's your turn to talk next. So we finally answered that question from the sequel trilogy. So,
well, I can definitely say that the Magic 8 Ball has once again betrayed me. So I will go ahead and say that none of us should be surprised by that. But what we should be surprised by is if you haven't had a chance yet to go over and give us a rating and review over on Apple Podcasts, because, of course, we'd really appreciate it. And here we are on the Nerd Party. So go to thenerdparty.com/contact and reach out to us and let us know what you think, what we should be talking about, and what we got right, what we got wrong. We just love talking to people. It's what we do. It's podcasting. It's talking. It's a thing. So there is going to be the return of Rey Skywalker in a movie that is set 15 years after the sequel trilogy, where I'm going to pull a direct quote from Ms. Kathleen Kennedy here, where she says, "Well, we're 15 years out from Rise of Skywalker, so we're post-war, post-First Order, and the Jedi are in disarray. There's a lot of discussion around who are the Jedi, what are they doing, what's the state of the galaxy. She's attempting to rebuild the Jedi Order based on the books, based on what she promised Luke, so that's where we're going. So, we're post-war, post-First Order, and the Jedi are in disarray as Rey is trying to rebuild them." So I think that puts us
in disarray. Is that a pun?
If it is, it's unintentional, but a delicious one. I got to ask, Matt, the wheels immediately start turning. The Jedi are in disarray. What can you imagine the starting point as here for this 15 years later movie?
Well, I do think that this is an interesting question, and mainly because, we know Luke is gone at this point. Of course, Ben Solo has died as well. And, we're not really sure what other Jedi may be around at this point. We don't know who's alive other than Rey. And so it does create, I think, I don't know, the quote from Kathleen Kennedy does seem a little bit strange that there would be disarray. It makes me, interested, though, and intrigued the thought of, okay, Rey's calling is to re-begin the Jedi Order, and what it should look like moving forward, what it should be, how it should be evolved in the rest of the galaxy is obviously a question that we would have hoped that Luke Skywalker would have been answering with his, Jedi Temple and workings with bringing back the Jedi. But of course, that's not the way the story went. And so that now falls to Rey to answer these questions. We know she has the Jedi Library, which will most likely be helpful for her. But we have all of this history. We've talked about it many a times here on this show, as well as the 602 Club when we've talked about Star Wars. This idea of the places in which, the Jedi got things wrong, and the ways in which, they were, too closely aligned with the government of the Republic at that time, and all these type of things, right? And these are all questions that, that Rey is going to have to answer and to try and figure out.
Yeah, I'm glad you say, too closely aligned with the government. Okay, let me just throw this out there that at the end of The Rise of Skywalker, what government?
Well, this is true. This is very true.
The New Republic is destroyed. they clearly state that. The First Order took over the galaxy, and now the First Order is done. If anything, this sounds a lot like the galactic state of being that we're getting with The Mandalorian, where, except, you know, obviously we have a resurgent empire with The Mandalorian and everything, but like, you know, the Republic's a joke. There isn't really a government. It's sort of a lawless time. Is that what we're looking at? Are we looking at sort of a, hey, that worked in The Mandalorian, let's make that Rey's world too? Do you think we're cruising in that direction?
So all of the EU books, you know, you think of the Thrawn trilogy and all of those things were, you think about the X-Wing series and all of those early books, right, were about the establishment of the New Republic in light of what had happened post-Return of the Jedi.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not something that we really ever got into with the sequel trilogy
at all.
And, you know, Mandalorian has subtly touched on some of that in the sense of kind of building to what we get in the sequel trilogy of a really ineffectual New Republic government, one that is too worried about too many different things, not really caring about anything that's really mattering. You have these warring factions inside it in the sense of political warring going on. They're too busy in and of themselves to care about what's really happening in the galaxy, you know, and the First Order is able to rise because they're basically treated as the JV squad that we don't really need to deal with, right? So this is fascinating to me because as I think about what Kathleen Kennedy is saying here, as well as the thought process of, you know, as you just mentioned, where this galaxy is at this moment, it actually does kind of feel like we're finally in a place where they're actually going to deal with the things that the post-Return of the Jedi novels actually did, but, you know, 40 years later, 45 years later. And because a lot of those questions are going to be having to be answered, and at this point, you don't have the you can't fall back on anybody. There's no Luke. There's no Leia. There's no Rey.
Here's the problem.
There's no Han. You know, there's none of these characters there. And so it really makes me wonder then, okay, so is that one of the reasons maybe we're wrapping up some of this Mando stuff? Is because maybe some of those characters are actually going to play into what we get in this.
But let me ask you this question, right? Like, you know, oh, there's no Luke, there's no Leia, there's no Han. Are we sure there's no Luke? Because Yoda made a guest appearance at a certain moment in the sequel trilogy, so we know the ghosts are in play. And I'm not
saying that that's not the case, but I'm just saying, I think what I'm trying to get at is just that those are not going to be characters we really, I think, get to have consistently, you know, like that. When I'm thinking of the post Return of the Jedi books, right? Those are the main characters, and so they may make guest appearances. And I'm sure if they're smart, they have to put Luke's Force Ghost in there at some point. Because otherwise, I mean, two, you want to utilize these characters before you can't. And the one you've got left that can come back is Mark Hamill as Luke Skywalker. So utilize him before he's gone as well. I mean, it would just be stupid to not do that. But I think, again, the question that we're kind of trying to figure out is like, all right, what is this world look like? And you know,
I think that the smartest possible thing they could do. I mean, what I think the smartest thing they could do is steer as far away from anything having to do with intricate world building as possible. And this is where some people might tear into me for putting it this way, but I don't think that the non-directly trained by Lucas storytellers in Star Wars are up to the horrifyingly complex questions of governance that that man seemed to be preoccupied with.
Mm-hmm.
That's a really, really oblique way of saying I haven't seen anybody outside of, say, a Tony Gilroy capable of laying the groundwork for, you know, like a Gilroy or a Filoni, obviously. Filoni, you know, trained at Lucas's knee, and the people in the animation division obviously are flexing what Lucas taught them and stuff like that. I didn't see anything in the sequel trilogy that indicated that they were up to the challenge of the complexity necessary for that.
Right.
And I'm not familiar enough with Stephen Knight. He's the acknowledged writer of this. I'm not familiar enough with what he's written to know if he's going to be interested, or even if Kathleen Kennedy or, and I may butcher the name and I apologize, but I'm not familiar enough with Charmaine Obaid-Chinoy. Is that how you pronounce her? I've only ever seen it written, so I don't know.
Yeah.
I think the smartest decision for them is to steer clear of it and have them have Rey acknowledge it, in the sense that I don't want to concern myself with that because that was the mistake that the Jedi made. And basically they have an out to keep it at arm's distance and be like, what happens in the galaxy isn't really our concern so much as, you know, making sure that the Force, you know, we're conduits for it.
Mm-hmm. Well, and, you know, one of the things I think that the movie could, and I think where could do, and where it could, I think it could be most successful then, and really in a way I think that I didn't find the sequel trilogy to be as successful personally, is the idea of this really focusing, as they're saying here, on the Jedi. And, you know, that's really just not something that we focused very much on. When you think of the story that we got there, there's very little of the actual Jedi Order, right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's something that, you know, of course, we haven't had a ton of, because, you know, the Mandalorian's not concerned with that type of storytelling. Nothing wrong with that. But also the Bad Batch is not concerned with that type of storytelling. It's not happening in Andor, right? That's not its place. So all of these stories have really, I think, not had one of the biggest parts of the Star Wars universe, which is the Jedi. And so I think that, like you said, if this story is focusing on this idea of who the Jedi Order is going to be as Rey looks to bring them back into the galaxy, I think that is actually a really interesting question. And I think one that's worth exploring, and if it done well, I think it could be a great film and a great series, most likely, right? To me, I think you're onto something, in the sense of if what Kathleen Kennedy said there is really the focus of this film, which is the Jedi, and that's the core, I think that's great, because I do think that that's a good question, right? You know, the why is always the most important question in Star Wars as to why we do something. And so what actually a new Jedi Order, which is what this is being labeled as, this is the era that we're going to be in, the new Jedi Order. I think that's a worthy question to actually create a film series out of.
While I love what you're saying there, the one challenge I think here is before the Mandalorian showed up, there was a decided aversion to the question of midichlorians, or as they have alluded to in Mando, M count. Can they have Rey searching for Jedi without some sort of acknowledgement of midichlorians at this point? Do you think that they eschew midichlorians entirely in this and just have her, right, I don't know, using a divining rod or something like that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is maybe a wild theory, but where we were with the EU, Luke was really that continuation of the Jedi Order and the through line. And of course, you know, the way that story went, that didn't really end up being the case of him kind of being the through line in that way.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to throw out to you, We know kind of where things are going with the Ahsoka series. They're going to do the Dave Filoni film, which is, it seems, is a kind of wrap up to all of what they're doing, which is seems to be building to basically a Thrawn trilogy type of storyline. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, so is basically in the end, is Ahsoka actually going to be our through line so that she would be somebody who could be there as a wizened old, you know, Jedi master? You could also still have somebody like a Grogu around, because by that point, Grogu's 45 years older. You know, Din Djarin might not actually even be alive at that point, because by that point, he would be very old, because he was born, I mean, he was a kid during the Clone Wars. And yes, even though people live a long time in the Star Wars
or universe, a little, wasn't it a little after the Clone Wars or something like that? Didn't he say it was a little after?
Possibly, but you know, my point I think still stands. Like, he'd be really old by the, you know,
he would.
So again, like I'm just kind of throwing it out there. Is that I feel like there is this possibility that our actual through line for all of Star Wars becomes Ahsoka, of being able to connect from the prequel trilogy all the way past, you know, the sequel trilogy.
I don't reject it out of hand. I don't think it's likely, specifically because of the fact that Ahsoka's story, I haven't seen anything that indicates that they would want to do that, because you would have included Ahsoka in the sequel trilogy if you wanted her, is the way I would put it. Or if they could have found a way to use her, setting aside anything else that might be out there that might have been in an article somewhere or something like that. I think that they wouldn't necessarily want to cloud the storytelling with Ahsoka for casual fans who might be coming to it and not get it. But additionally, it doesn't feel like this would be Ahsoka's story per se. And it feels... my sense of it would be, if you bring in Ahsoka, she would overshadow Rey in a large sense. I could be wrong. I could be way off for all I know. Whatever. It's fine. I'm not dismissing what you're saying out of hand. I'm playing that sort of like annoying skeptic role in the case of it, because I really think that what they want to do with this movie, and this is all just based on the little snippets of whatever, but my impression is that this is an effort to solidify and, for lack of a better term, legitimize Rey as a character.
Sure.
And to give her the complete spotlight.
You know, I think the thing that I, and the reason I came to that is that there's a great quote from Kathleen Kennedy as she was talking to everybody, you know, about Star Wars and what's coming up and all of this. And I don't have the exact quote, but she was talking about the way in which Star Wars is an interconnected story, that everything that happens is connected together. And in many ways, I was really struck by the fact that she said that, because I think that is one of the things that I think most fans would have said as well, that what makes Star Wars special is that every single piece of it matters, because it's building into a continuous whole. And so I just lay that before you to say, like, I don't think it's necessary. I 100% get where you're coming from and the criticism of whether or not that would actually work, right? And whether or not they would actually do that. But I could see a way in which it almost seems like to me that even with the new timeline that they've given, in the sense of, you know, having these different eras and plotting them all out, you know, on an outline for us, is to say that yes, all of these things are connected. This is, you know, we're not just trying to do one-offs here. You know, we're trying to figure out how this plays into the whole. And so, I don't know. It seems like a really interesting idea to me because, in some ways, yes, that allows you to be able to kind of find those connection points that are still available to you that aren't available anymore because of the loss of, you know, somebody like Carrie and, you know, the death of characters in films and makes them difficult to bring back. So, I don't know if it's going to happen. I just think it would be great if that was the case. So, especially when we're talking about the Jedi, and in all honesty, probably the Jedi that would have any weight that we would know of that's probably going to be left by that point would actually be Ahsoka.
I agree.
I know you're not disagreeing. I appreciate you pushing back because I think there's a lot of validity to what you're saying, in all honesty.
It's such a fraught conversation, specifically because I own it. Everybody on planet Earth who's ever spoken to me knows that the sequel trilogy did not land well with me. And you know that I'm hopeful because I regard every sequel as an opportunity to make the previous entry even better. Happened that way with Avatar. I didn't like Avatar. Didn't really care for it. Went into Avatar Way of Water. I was like, I kind of like Avatar now because I liked Avatar Way of Water. I hope this movie redeems the sequel trilogy. I hope it makes me go, okay, this was the worthwhile journey. We got to the point where I'm like, okay, I get it. But the thing I can't help letting go of, this is sort of like, I think, a final point to close out on, is yes, you know, I push back a little bit, but I acknowledge the validity of what you're saying about Ahsoka. And again, I get back to, in my head, the Jedi are in disarray. The galaxy presumably is going to be in a state of some sort of chaos with a government that's trying to set itself up. And no empire, and therefore there's probably going to be criminal elements running rampant. And Rey's going to be trying to hold the legacy of the Jedi together while potentially being counseled by a wise old Jedi who's ready to pass the torch. A lot of this stuff sounds like ideas that Lucas was bringing to the table for the sequel trilogy, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So, and if they do that, it will feel like we went through the sequel trilogy just to get to a point where we should have started from to begin with.
Sure. Yeah.
Am I fair in feeling like that would be a little frustrating?
I 100% believe that you would feel that feeling would be legitimate. I think I would feel the same way as well. And, you know, I think that the thought process of, you know, moving into this time period again, one that, look, whether you loved it or hated it, this was a period in Star Wars and a group of Star Wars films that I think was more fraught with problems for a lot of fans, more so than even the prequel era. And like you said, I 100% agree with you that, you know, there's definitely been times in films to which, you know, I went into a second film and came out of it more excited about the overall whole of a series because that second film was able to do something. You know, obviously, I think a great example you gave was recently with Avatar Way of Water. But I also think of, you know, and many people felt like this too, right? Star Trek II completely made people back on fire for Star Trek because Star Trek, the motion picture, wasn't as well received and panned by many fans. So,
and let's keep in mind that Nicholas Meyer came on board and he wasn't even a Star Trek fan. He had done nothing like that before. And from what I know of this director, she's not known for... I know that she worked on Miss Marvel, so she's obviously worked in a franchise before, but the vast majority of her career has been bent toward a different thing other than a Star Wars type of movie. So maybe this is the spark that's necessary to reinvigorate things, especially about that time period.
Mm-hmm.
It could happen.
Well, yeah. I mean, I like that idea that, you know, our goal here is to spark the Force again, you know? You know, and it's interesting, too. I mean, you've got a writer here who has done things like he did Peaky Blinders. He wrote the movie Spencer about Diana Spencer. You know, he worked on the show C that was on Apple TV that Jason Momoa was in. You know, he wrote a movie called Burnt that Bradley Cooper was in. He did a movie called Amazing Grace. I mean, like, so he has a very... eclectic group of work. He has an eclectic collection of work that he's done. You know, he's not easily pigeonholed, it seems like. So I am going to be interested to see what it is that they are able to come up with. You know, on top of that, you know, I know that James Mangold, who is going to be doing the Dawn of the Jedi era, has apparently talked to Dave Filoni. And I'm guessing it seems to me as though Dave is becoming more and more ingrained into all things Star Wars. And that, you know, if you want to do something Star Wars wise, you kind of have to run it by the man. And so... hopefully, whatever story that they are coming up with, they are, you know, running it by Dave as well, just to be able to make sure that we're being consistent from beginning the Dawn of the Jedi all the way to, you know, what we're going to get here with the new Jedi Order, which would make sense, right? Because that, again, that goes to what Kathy was talking about in that quote that I was referencing, this idea that this is one continuous story, and therefore you do need... stuff that feels consistent for the universe and makes sense within the universe. And so, you know, that's a great idea. So hopefully that kind of stuff is happening as well. And, you know, in all honesty, it's Star Wars and I want it to be good, right? You know,
of course.
I want this film to be good, regardless of whether or not I liked the sequel trilogy. One of the things that I am excited about is that I always enjoyed Daisy Ridley. I thought she was a great actress, and she absolutely deserved even more than I thought that the sequel trilogy gave her, because I thought she just, the character was interesting, and she just deserved more. That was maybe one of my main frustrations with the trilogy, is that it just didn't give these characters enough to do. But, John, we haven't even talked about... I mean, don't you need to bring back, like, John Boyega? Doesn't Poe need to be coming back into this series? I mean, like, aren't there some characters here that we should be... I mean, especially since we know Finn is Force-sensitive.
You have to bring Finn back.
Yeah. I mean, you can't not have Finn in this story.
I would like to say that that's 100% yes, but... at that point, we're trying to, you know, look into the future, and Yoda warned us about that. And, you know, always in motion it is. But I think
it's true.
I think Poe is optional. You can write him out being like, oh, he's off with the government. We're not concerned with the government. And then you can have Finn and say, yeah, I do need Finn. And finally get Finn to be the character that they originally envisioned him to be before The Last Jedi completely undid him. And really, really go off in that direction, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think that there are a lot of story possibilities. You know, as a famous Vulcan from another Star franchise said, there are always possibilities. And I think there is still a lot on the table for this new Jedi Order era. And so there is a, I would say, a... spark of hope that this would be good.
And I always have the spark of hope that we will deliver a good episode of Aggressive Negotiations. I think we have this time. But if anybody out there wants to harass you, being scandalized by our opinions about the future of Star Wars storytelling as it pertains to Daisy Ridley portraying Rey Skywalker, where can they find you online?
Well, the best places to find me are all over social media. I am active most on Twitter, Instagram, Letterboxd, and Vero, and my name there in all of those places is MattRushing02. Of course, here on the network, you'll find me doing Owl Post, which is a completed show at the moment. We may be bringing it back. You never know, because we got a big announcement about Harry Potter stuff. And we covered every single chapter of the Harry Potter series, one chapter at a time. Over on the TFM network, you'll find me doing a bunch of shows. One is called the 602 Club, which John is a frequent guest over there. And in fact, as this episode is coming out to you, you will have an episode of the 602 Club where we're talking about the Bad Batch. So you will want to check that out, because it is, as always, when John and I talk about the Bad Batch, it's going to be a blast. You can also find me doing Literary Treks, The Orb, Warp 5, Saddle Up, and The Artificial Tango all over there on the TFM network. But John, if people want to catch the best place to get a Ronto wrap, where would they find you?
Oh, the best place to get a Ronto wrap actually is at the source. Go to the Mos Eisley Cantina and just stand outside and see what happens. But you can find me as Kessel Junkie out there on the space lanes. You can find me on Letterboxd on social media. That's the most fun place. It's I get in the least amount of trouble there. And you can find me right here on the network co-hosting a show called House Lights, where we look at the work of directors by different categorizations, eras, decades, every single which way we can possibly think of it. And, you know, outside of that, I think actually it's time to close these negotiations.
John, negotiations are closed.
Join the revolution. Join the Nerd Party.